got my founding shirt on. Because we've got a lot of founders among us this year. So please, one more time, if you're a founding teammate from KIPP Upper Roseville, from Newark Community Prep, from Newark Mile High School, from KIPP Liberty, please stand up and recognize. Secondly, we have a lot of new teammates in the room. So could new teammates, people new to our network, please stand up and give a warm welcome. Thank you. let's give special thanks to Ashley Houghton, whose countless hours behind the scenes are really what made this possible. Now, before we move on to what's next for our network, I want to take a minute to recognize that this week our nation lost a true national treasure, perhaps until now our greatest living writer. I'm referring, of course, to Toni Morrison. I was fortunate enough to meet Ms. Morrison once, along with a couple of our students and teachers, and to call her an inspiration would be a tremendous understatement. So I thought it'd be fitting to frame my comments today with a quote. If there's a book you want to read that hasn't been written yet, then you must write it. When we started Team Academy back in 2002, it was largely a reaction against what we had seen in the district schools we worked in, the crushing bureaucracy, the abuse of teachers, and most of all, the horrific treatment we saw in the schools of the kids who we were supposed to be educating. That's not all schools, by the way, that's the schools we taught in. Particularly those who everyone labeled the bad kids, and they had given up on, sometimes as early as 9 or 10 years of age. As we looked for a way to build a school that worked for all kids, people kept pointing us to KIPP, and we found in KIPP a place where we could run the school the way we wanted to, write the book we felt needed to be written. And as the years went by, that book took shape, while the names of the founders were printed on the cover, Shaw, Heidi, Lauren, Tia, Jim. The words on the pages have been written ever since by the teachers and leaders and the students who came later. We would build that school and the schools that followed on a few key principles that made our book a little different than the ones that were already on the shelf. We care about all the kids in our cities. Getting a world-class education, all means all. We never give up on the good kids and certainly not on those who've been labeled bad. We love our kids the way a parent loves a child, caring about their long-term success and happiness over anything else. On the way back from KIPP School Summit last Thursday, a reporter called me for an article he was writing. He was wondering why some charter schools refuse to take in kids mid-year, refuse to backfill, and more to the point, why we do. I said, well, we just see it as mission critical. Our vision is for world-class education for all kids in our cities, so we have to do our part. So then he said, yeah, but isn't it hard to get those mid-year entrants caught up? Doesn't it make it harder to do your job? I said, but that is our job. Our job is a lot more than just getting high test scores at the end of the year. And if we want it easy, there's lots of easier jobs we could have taken. But educational inequity was built and reinforced systematically over more than 200 years. We didn't think dismantling that would be easy. Or as Ms. Morrison might say, we didn't get in this to keep writing the easy books that have already been written. The article that he wrote has made some noise and hopefully will encourage others to follow our lead. But as you know, this is just backfilling. This is one of the things we do that are key to our mission, but might make it harder to get high test scores. It might make it easier to get scores if like some schools, we didn't have recess in elementary school, so we could just focus on academics. We know we could do months and months and months of test prep or teach directly to the test. We know we could hold back kids who don't pass the test. We know we could kick out the bad kids. We know that if we did those things, our scores would probably improve. There are lots of charter, district, and private schools that do these things for that reason. But we don't, because while we value high student achievement, we don't want to get it through shortcuts. We're going to write it our way. And that way has been working. A couple months ago, the state of New Jersey honored 11 districts across the state for being lighthouse districts. Beacons of success for public education in New Jersey. And our schools in Newark were the first ever from Essex County to win this award, which is based on our academic gains across the last few years. And in Camden, our schools have been on the same trajectory and were recently studied by Stanford's esteemed Credo Institute. Credo found such large academic gains from Renaissance schools like ours. The Camden's achievement growth now matches the greatest gains ever seen in American education. chapter in the book is the one about Miami, and while Sunrise doesn't yet have a state test, we have seen big gains by their kids on internal assessments, and this bodes very well for the future down in Liberty City. We don't do this work for attention in newspapers, of course, but these headlines do matter, because they send the world a message it unfortunately needs to hear. I mean, how pathetic is it that this headline needs to be written in the year 2019? There have been kids from low-income families achieving great things long before any of us were on this earth. Yet somehow the world doesn't believe. And the existence of this myth, of course, hurts our kids every day, from when they apply to college, or for jobs, or just walk down the street. And what objective results like our test scores do is shine a light on the fact that our kids are indeed brilliant. They throw this fact in the faces of those who would doubt them, so they can't deny the existence of their excellence, can't make excuses when they don't help their kids achieve all they can. And yes, this goes for us too. When our performance lags, we also can't make excuses because we know from experience that we can do better. A couple weeks ago, we got our state test scores back in New Jersey. It's a new test, and to some degree, we don't really know what to make of the scores. But on their face, they look like they're down, quite a bit in math, a little less in ELA. So what are we going to make of this? Well, we certainly need to take them seriously, because the tests matter, and what they seem to be saying is our kids didn't learn as much last year as they should have. And that's not good. Then again, we're also not going to freak out, because we have other data points like reading levels and QAs that didn't change from year to year, and on which our kids' achievement looks similar to or better than the year before. So what are we going to do? In a nutshell, we're going to stay the course with our instructional vision and plan. Our vision has always been about building a strong foundation for lifelong learning, and it still is. Our plan has always included getting higher and higher academic results, even than the ones we were getting, better and better each year, and it still does. This year's step in that plan, as you know, is our academic priority. Our kids love to learn, and we do too. Because as we all know, kids who love learning learn more. Now, this doesn't mean every class is a magic show and a circus and Disney World rolled into one, though if you can pull that off, more power to you. No, building a true lifelong love of learning comes not through antics, but through careful preparation, deep understanding of the subject material, response to data, and student work to ensure that all our kids are experiencing success. Actually, come to think of it, that is a lot like Disney World. At Disney World, every single detail of the customer experience is incredibly well thought out, informed by data about how the customers react to everything they do. The opportunities for engagement diverse enough that people enjoy themselves, whether they're 1 year old or 100. I even found out in doing a little research on this, they have mouse prints on their manhole covers. Now that's attention to detail. This fanatical preparation for every possible customer, or in our case, every student's experience in our classrooms, is exactly what will lead us to the highest levels of engagement for our kids, and ultimately the highest levels of achievement as well. The Magic Kingdom isn't magic. It's built on obsessive preparation, practice, and execution in service of the optimal customer experience. In other words, the same thing our best teachers do every single day. Now I'll close with this. This idea of long-term success has been on my mind a lot lately. I was thinking about it last week at KSS because we had almost 40 alumni there. We had alums like Marlon and Brittany talking on panels about the success they've had starting their own ventures. We had alums like Khalil and Adorian competing in a pitch competition against kipsters from around the country for funding for organizations they started. A prize that Adorian won, by the way. Everywhere I went, someone would yell out, "Mr. Hill," and I'd turn around and see a kid, an adult now, who I remember teaching mathematics or multiplication tables to. And then our KIPP through college team organized a dinner, and it got even better. It was in a restaurant so fancy that one of the dishes actually had fried crickets on it, and like worms, on purpose. I mean, I've had bugs on my plate before in restaurants, but not on purpose. That's how nice this place was. But the point of the dinner was to get everyone together so we could all catch up. I talked to Marlon and Takai about film production, talked to Khalil about his menswear company. He thought he could hook me up with something nicer than the 10-year-old Team Academy shirt. He said there's nothing nicer than that. I know how to get it. I know how to get the rise out of them. So I talked to Lauren Simmons, who you all know is the second African-American woman in history to work on the New York Stock Exchange. And the update there is she's no longer on the Stock Exchange because she now has a book deal and a movie deal, and they are hopeful that she'll be able to get Ava DuVernay to produce it. You know, the same stuff you and I were doing when we were 24. And then of course, the alums have come back to work with us. Hi, Alexis, Kendra, Robert, Naila, Kenyatta. I'm sure I'm leaving someone out. It was so great to see them all in one room. But the best part came next. After a few words from their teachers, one by one, a number of them got up, the alums got up to speak. And they told a lot of stories, lots of reminiscing. There were a few roasts. Monet said that she's an asshole now because Shaw and I are assholes and she can't help it. There was a lot of gratitude for the things that their teachers did for them, to the point where we got uncomfortable, things that we didn't even always remember doing, but they sure did. There was a ton of gratitude for their classmates, for people like Robert, who had been big brothers to so many of them. And there was inspiration from those who have found their passion or those whose road to success has been littered with tremendous obstacles that they've overcome one by one. And what really surprised me was the degree to which there was ownership. This group felt passionate about KIPP New Jersey. This doesn't mean they have no criticisms, but I was frankly shocked by how much responsibility they all feel to make sure future generations get to experience KIPP New Jersey as good and even better than they did. After the dinner, a Dorian came up to me and asked, "Now that you have your own kids, has anything changed about how you view this work?" My answer that night was that I think doing this work informed my parenting more than the other way around. But having thought about it some more, I think the right answer is this. As a parent, you operate in two opposing worlds of urgency and patience. On the one hand, you don't want anything to go wrong ever. On the other hand, you know that things have to go wrong for your kids to learn. And more than anything, you get dialed in and you focus completely on the long game. I think that's what I've learned from being a parent. The long game is the only one that matters. The last thing I said to our alums that night was that I've never been more inspired by the long-term prospects for all that our organization can do, even after those who founded it are long gone. Because while we got the ball rolling, they will be the ones to keep it going. But of course, Toni Morrison's metaphor is better. This is a story. A story written by everyone in this room, each contributing our own page, a story written by our students, and a story that will be finished by our alumni. It's not the story of KIPP New Jersey or KIPP Miami, but the story of whole communities working for better life outcomes for all our kids. And it's a story that hopefully one day will be so normal, so expected of cities in America, that nobody will even bother to read it. Thank you, let's have a great summit, and let's have a great year.